There's no good opening for this one. I was trying to think of something. I got nothing. You guys ready?
Josh Hartnett is better than this.
Oh, there's a good opening. Josh Hartnett is better than this. So hi, welcome to After the Hype. With me, your host, always Brian Dressel. With me, as always, is Jonathan Hardesty.
Hi.
And Chewie Darso.
Hello.
Welcome to the month of October. We're here at After the Hype. We are going to go through a bunch of horror movies that we randomly picked. Usually I try to come up with some theme for the month of October.
Yeah.
And this year I'm just like, just ones we like. Yeah. Just kind of go through your old repertoire.
Something I wanted to see, and then something I wanted you to see.
Yep, and then I picked out just one of my favorite vampire movies that we just never covered on here, and then for the fourth week, we just kind of went first person reply out of our crew, and then Chewie was the first, so she got to pick two movies this month.
Yeah.
Cool.
So we're starting things off with our best foot forward with...
It's 30 days of please listen after this.
Yeah. The rest of the movies are better. This one will still be a very fun episode.
John, I'm curious as to why you chose this
one. We'll get to that.
Yeah.
After Where Have You Been Doing? Oh. Aren't you excited for Where Have You Been Doing?
What have I been doing?
I love asking the question, Where Have You Been Doing, just for the immediate response in Chewie's face of, I always forget about this segment.
No, it's
just, in the 5 years I've done this podcast.
It's not that I forget about this this segment. It's that I forget to make sure I do something.
Fair enough. I will go first in that case. I have finished Assassin's Creed Origins. It was good. It was different than all the other Assassin's Creed games, which is really jarring in the beginning and then really nice by the end. But all said and done, it feels like a really good trial run, I guess, is the way I want to say it, of a game that they actually want to make, which I'm hoping is Odyssey. Like, okay. There's so many rough edges and so many just kind of like half-baked ideas. And then everything I read about Odyssey and it being apparently one of the best games ever, I'm like, okay, so I'm just guessing that just kind of took whatever worked here and expanded upon it there. And I just punched my mic.
It was so good that you punched your mic.
And there we go.
Sponsored by Newer.
Yeah. But yeah, all in all, I think it was a good game. It was definitely worth my time. But I'm far more excited to play Odyssey now. Like, that's all it kind of did was, as soon as I kind of figured out what the game was, I just plowed through the story. I think I finished it in maybe under 30 hours, which is the game has on average 40, so I really flew through it.
Right. Did the game let you do that for the most part, or was it still really trying to get you in that Assassin's Creed way, like, no, spend some time doing some stuff that was okay once or twice, but you don't want to do it again?
Yeah, it definitely. Well, not. It doesn't get redundant like that. It gets redundant in a different way.
Okay. Like how Black Flag is it?
It's way better than Black Flag. I mean, the game itself might not be better just coherently.
I just mean, like, in terms of locking you behind stuff that you feel like you've already done enough of.
Black Flag was the worst. Like, that was absolutely the worst.
Okay.
But... yeah, this one is much better at that, but still has significant problems with it.
Did the DLC that they promised come out where it was just explore educational, like the edutainment version of...
Maybe. I've already moved on.
Okay.
I'm now playing a different game, so if it's there, I'm just not going to do it. I know it's in Odyssey because I saw all the ads for Odyssey. I'm not sure.
Or it might have been Odyssey. I think I had it switched around. Never mind.
But yeah, that's it for me. John, what about you?
So I mentioned a couple of weeks ago that I started watching Carnival Row, and so I finished it.
Oh, nice.
And I still fairly enjoyed it. I would say my chief criticism coming out of it is that when it got to its more political themes and messages, it was so on the nose and obvious. And it kind of undercuts itself. It's about immigration as an overall theme, but they feature fairies and other fantastical creatures. But most of the people in Carnival Row are white. So there's this weird kind of shift of, like, you're trying to do this immigration thing, but your leads, at least the people who get the most screen time, are Orlando Bloom and Cara Delevingne.
I can't pronounce her last name.
Yeah. So if I'm close, cool. But yeah, so they're
the Enchantress. You can just say Enchantress. I know who you mean.
Right, the Enchantress. So they're kind of the stand-in for the problems with immigration. And so then it starts to crack at the seams of the political end of it, but the intentions are good, I think. I think if they had more time with it, or more, like, if they can spend more time in that world and put nuance to it, I think it'll be much better. But so far, I mean, the eight episodes are solid, and the mystery is interesting. Like, that's the main thing that hooked me in, was there's a murder mystery. So when they've got to solve that, amidst this backdrop, which was a little bit more obvious in the political thing, but
yeah,
still enjoyable. And it's fantasy that doesn't seem to have a source material other than just the person wrote it. And, you know, it's solid. It's the guy who wrote Pacific Rim, Beecham.
Oh, nice.
So it's solid, and the fantasy elements are really cool. So
I have to get that one a shot at some point. Chewie, what about you?
Oh, sorry. Turn up your brightness, though. Just as a warning, It is a dark, dark show.
Good to know.
Well, we watched a couple episodes of Swamp Thing recently.
We did.
And the most I can say about that show is all of the side characters I don't care about.
Yeah.
I really just want more Swamp Thing out of my Swamp Thing.
Oh my God, Swamp Thing is so good in Swamp Thing.
He's really good every time he's on screen.
But it's rare. He's not in it a whole bunch.
It's very little. It's very, very held back from the actual Swamp Thing. Other than that, something that's quite fantastic, if you guys did not see it, on Geekology.com, they shared a video, a training video, of what to do with an unruly cat in a veterinary office. And it is amazing because the unruly cat is reenacted by one of the male vets. So they pull him out of the cage, and then they try to subdue him, and they try to control him, and he just starts running around the whole, like, lab, throwing stuff around, jumping on the counter, and then you have to trink him eventually, and he just comes, yeah. It is an amazing video of how to deal with an unruly cat.
Does he get hooked on the trank?
I don't think so. He does throw a box at a woman.
It really reminds me of have you ever seen the video? Have you ever seen Will Ferrell's audition video for SNL?
No.
He has the best audition video for SNL.
Yeah.
It apparently got him on the show quicker than anyone's audition video ever, and it's Will Ferrell pretending to be a cat.
Oh.
And he started doing it. He's like, I'm pretty sure this is going to end my career. And Lauren saw 30 seconds when hire him.
He's funny.
And then, like, when he does his Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee, he does a bit of it for Jerry, and he kills Jerry. Just full on. He's like, no, because you got to do... And, like, just the way he does it, it's like, wow, fuck, Will Ferrell is part cat.
But
he's very much committed to the bit.
And yeah.
If you want to watch this video, I don't have it in front of me right now for what it is called on YouTube, but on Geekology.com, and that's Geekology with an IE, it says, Oscar-worthy man pretends to be an unruly cat for veterinary technician training video.
That's just it's just amazing.
So I highly recommend to go and watch that.
I really feel like you could have sent that to the pirate and he would have been like, oh, what a great way to get me drank. What a dangerous polar bear. You better put the pirate down just to be safe.
Hey, so you put so remember how I asked you about that drink?
Here, since now we can make sure everyone hears it. This is me handing a drink to Chewie.
Putting it even further away from me on the floor. Not wanting to share. What are you teaching our son?
He's not in the room.
To not share with mom.
He can feel the unsharing.
He's actually very good at sharing. He's far better than me.
He does not like me asking him for his pacifier now, though.
No, but now he has tried to shove his water in my mouth whenever I'm near. If he's holding a water, wah-wah, ow!
Into your teeth.
Why did I open this door? Oy. So 30 days a night.
Yeah.
Really quick before we do start Halloween month, I should mention that last week you might have noticed that our promised episode of First Man did not come out. And that happened because I crashed a scooter on the day that I was supposed to edit, and there was absolutely no way I was going to start editing with my busted ass arm, which is still busted today, and it sucks a whole bunch. So First Man will be shelved until after our horror movie month of October, and will come out at some point in November. I'm just not sure when yet, but it still will come out. Just all of our Where Have You Been Doings will be severely dated.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
And there were some audio problems as well, which is partially why I did not release it, because I have to clean that up and edit it. And that's going to take too much time with a broken arm. Not broken arm, but busted up arm.
Okay.
So that's where we are. That's why you did not hear First Man last week. And you just got to listen to our amazing episode of Batman vs. Superman, which is a very good episode. Yeah. Might be a better episode than movie, if you didn't like the movie. I love the movie.
I'm sure there are people out there listening to this who didn't love the movie.
There's
and who are very excited to have that episode pop out again.
I hope so.
Yeah.
So 30 days a night, John, you had originally picked a movie that was just fucking unavailable, which was weird. Happy Death Day.
Yeah, Happy Death Day. The idea behind that was like, I like Groundhog's Day well enough, and I like the premise of that. To have that in a slasher thing, I was like, oh, I want to see it. Missed it in the theaters, and I was like, let's watch it for this. We have the excuse. Let's do it.
Yeah.
And not available at all.
Yeah. You can rent the sequel.
You can rent a sequel, but you have to buy the...
Yeah. And I didn't really want to buy it. You didn't really want to buy it.
No,
so,
I wasn't that curious.
I watched it on a plane, so I wasn't that curious either. And honestly, I think I was going to say we dodged a bullet because I didn't really like the movie, but then here we are.
Well, there was also...
third choice.
Yeah, well, a bit of a longer journey than that, really, because I had a string of movies I was picking that were not available. Because I also thought, well, maybe A Tale of Two Sisters. I really enjoyed that one.
It's a good movie.
Cannot buy or rent. It was like, you can't have it in the U.S. It's like, well...
Probably the American remake that kind of sucked.
The Uninvited.
Was that what it was?
Elizabeth Banks, I think.
Yes, that's
right. Yeah. No. I knew they made that. I was like, I saw that and wasn't that curious to see it again. But yeah, that wasn't available. And so then I kept going down the list and it was like, there's nothing that's easy for us to watch. What's something that's just bloody, gory, has monsters and is maybe... And then I came across 30 Days a Night, which had the Alaska wintry setting. I was like, you know what? I miss snow. Let's watch. Let's do this.
There you go.
Yeah.
Had you seen it before this?
Yes. When it came out in theaters, actually.
Okay. Yeah. I was at the same boat. I remember seeing it in theaters and going, woof.
I did not see it in
that
theaters.
That was mediocre at best.
I had never seen this movie before.
Were you familiar with it, though?
I knew of it. I knew it was from a comic book and everything. But I just always remember hearing, it's not good. Yeah, and then we watched it.
What was your review then?
It's not good. And it's so confusing because David Slade directed this, and he's a good director.
Yeah.
There's so many things about this movie that are so curious watching it again, like Ben Foster's in this.
Ben Foster.
And David Slade did this, and there's all these elements, and there's just like, wait, these people are in this. This is of a caliber, but this isn't good.
No.
It's
and
no-
they, even the villain from Wonder Woman, what's his name? He's the main vampire villain.
Oh yeah,
like
in American Horror Story.
Danny Houston was in Wonder Woman.
Yeah, he's the guy that she thought was the.
And he's just vampiring the hell out of what he's doing his own thing and having a blast. It looks like
him and Ben Foster did not know what movie they were in.
They were the only good things. They should just go be a movie together and leave everyone else because no one else seemed to care.
Really quick before we go too far down the rabbit hole, just in case people didn't know that this movie existed, John, can you tell us just what it's about?
So essentially in the northernmost city in Alaska, Barrow, I think it is. It's like Barrow, the farthest north. They get 30 days a night. So the sun is just not out for 30 days. And so for whatever reason, they hunker down, lock it down. People who can leave fly away and people who don't just stay. And I guess either drink or fuck. I don't know. But
probably both.
Yeah. So then essentially Ben Foster, this interloper, comes in and starts removing all the burner cell phones, cutting power, destroying all the things that people would need to survive.
Killed all the dogs,
the sled dogs that could actually help people escape. And then vampires come to town and slaughter almost everybody. And so for the next like 29 days, the small fragment of people have to survive to the next sunlight. And Josh Hartnett is the main like sheriff of this town of Barrow, and he's just trying to do the best he can with his estranged family and his estranged wife and his estranged brother as the vampires come in and wreck all the shit.
And then he takes
vampire blood at the end and fights the vampire and punches a hole in his head and dies with the sun. it's so funny.
You know, it was done better in Van Helsing when he became a werewolf.
And even that wasn't good.
Yeah.
I think the main thing, as I was watching this again, I was like, what? Like, what's the spark I can get from this? And the weird choice in rock music that they put in this.
Sure.
And the very bad and cheesy end where it just becomes a brawl and he CGI punches his face out. It's just like, okay, this is a thing. This is a monster of its own.
I have to say, my biggest problem with this movie, the monster problem of this movie, is that they are awful at showing the passage of time.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes.
Without the little ticker on the bottom that says day 7, day 18, day 20. Like, you would assume it was one evening.
Right.
No one changes. their hair length, their facial hair, it's all the same.
They try to do a little stubble for Josh Hartnett, but you try to put stubble on Josh Hartnett.
It doesn't.
It's not working.
And they don't really sustain injuries. There's no real discussion about food. They go to a grocery store once. But and are they supposed to be carrying around 30 days worth of food?
That's a lot of food.
Yeah. For like the 8 people they are. And then the one token ethnic, in quotations, person or indigenous quotations, whichever quotation you want.
Oh, yeah.
Guy is Samoan. He's not Alaskan. He's about as least Alaskan as you can get. A very tropical island. And I was just like, this is stupid.
It's not. See, for me, the problems are many. So I'd like to try to stay with like the positive, at least the very little I can. And unfortunately, the best thing in the movie gets taken out, what, halfway through? Ben Foster, maybe a third of the way in?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He's not in it very long, and then he gets killed.
It's kind of like the Renfield of this group of vampires.
Yeah, and like he's kind of the Renfield, but the other thing that I really clued into on the rewatch is that he kind of has the entire, maybe first half of the movie, has a real Western vibe to it.
Yeah.
Of like the sheriff in the little town, and he's the only law there, and one guy comes riding in. And he's like the calm before the storm. He's like, they're coming for you. You better hitch up. And it's like,
it's kind of doing like a weird, the outlaws are going to come to town and challenge the sheriff thing. And actually kind of an interesting and compelling setup for that location.
Yeah.
And that premise.
And I really wish they had stuck with that Western vibe. Because when it was a Western just set in Alaska, I'm like, this is fun.
And it wasn't just a Western thing. Like, it started out with a lot of references to the thing.
Yeah.
With him going through the snow on his own, like the dog.
Yep.
And then killing all the dogs before anyone else dies. And it's just like, there's a lot of references to the thing at the beginning. So I'm like, oh, is this going to be like an interesting homage? Is going to be fun stuff going on?
It's kind of like if the thing was a Western, was the idea in the beginning. It's like, I'm kind of into this. And then it just loses whatever the hell spark that was real fast. Mm-hmm. Pretty much when it goes full Joe Dante Gremlins, it's just like, all right, well, this is over.
And even the gremlins had more personality than the vampires in this.
The vampires are just kind of jerks.
But they're not even jerks. They're just, they have their leader who talks. None of the other ones talk. They just kind of go around hissing at people.
Right.
And I'm like, that's not menacing in the way that I think you're intending it to be.
It's like for the first half, how meticulous and specific the things are in the movie. They just don't put any of that to the vampires.
No.
Especially even when the right-hand woman to the main vampire guy gets UV lighted and then he just breaks her neck. It's like, well, there's no established, like, she's just been by his right side the whole time. So, like, that's all we know of her.
And that's all you know of any of the other ones. You know the bald one because he's always there and he was in the trailers a whole bunch, which I can still remember. You know the, I don't even know his name. There's one guy that's like the only movie he ever did, but he was always kind of prominent.
The one that kind of looked like Adam Driver.
Yeah, a little bit. A little lanky, a little tall. Like that guy who's around. But like you don't really get to know any of him. Even the main guy you don't get to know. He's just like the one who talks.
He's the one who talks and he spouts all this stuff that suggests that he has more to him.
Yeah.
But when you realize there isn't more to him, it's just we went through a random phrase generator to get our mysterious vampire thing.
Yeah, let's
like, we should have come here centuries ago.
But like why?
And why? Yeah, I don't think this town was there centuries ago, and I don't think there would have had a high population centuries ago.
So and the other thing
I disagree
is,
with you.
Yeah, one, I disagree with you because of that. Two, it's not like you can do this every year. It's not like every year, like, all right, well, everybody got murdered in Barrow. Time to move in. Like, look at all this real estate. Oh, it's burned to the ground. Look at all this land. Should we try to build a town here again when it burned to the ground and nobody was able to help because nothing's around? Maybe we shouldn't.
I mean,
and there's even that throwaway line.
This is how it worked with the tsunamis.
True.
There's even the throwaway line where like they'll hit the next town, and then the next town. It's like, but is that their goal? Like, that's nothing of that is established or found out or discovered. Because if they talk, then they're gonna plan. I would like to point. I mean, one thing that I thought was actually interesting and kind of a positive thing until it devolved at the very end was that the gore didn't look too bad at first until it got to the very end. They cut a lot of people's heads off in this. And there were a few times where, like, I think the best friend in the warehouse where when Josh Hartnett had to cut his head off, that looked pretty realistic. It They took some care in very interesting places in this movie, and then just absolutely no care in others. But I liked the effects, at least for the most part, in this movie.
But even with the great effects of the best friend getting his head chopped off, it's just downplayed by the fact that you could just throw him in that grinder behind him, he'll be dead in half a second.
Yep.
Or you could slowly chop his head off and have him feel every thunk.
Oh, yeah.
Well, he was mad at his friend for killing his family, and his ex-wife is mad at him she's mad at Eben, which is his name?
Josh Hartnett.
Josh Hartnett's name in the movie, for not wanting kids. So there's drama there.
Yeah. That never feels too thought out.
No.
No.
I don't want kids, but I'm going to be specifically sensitive to this man killing his kids.
I guess.
Because suddenly family is everything. Like, it's...
Well,
yeah,
you
all
don't
those...
do that! You don't do that! I guess.
I had the same feeling towards when he's just like, we have the advantage. We have lived in this town our whole lives. We know this town, and we know the cold. And I'm like, they're vampires. They don't feel the cold. And if you knew the cold, you'd be going out there with hoods that fit and face masks.
Yeah.
And if you really knew that... We know this town. Everyone knows this town. I know this town. It's one road.
Yeah.
It's one road, a couple of buildings all spread out.
Yeah, like, way to go. You know the town.
Yeah, the dialogue in this movie is... I don't know if it was lifted straight from
the comic,
was it? You said that he wrote the screenplay?
Yeah, same writer as who wrote the comic.
It might have sold itself better in comic book form, but in a movie, it all feels empty and not thought out.
Well, that's a comic book dialogue is always cheesy and says more than needs to, and it always works. I love it in comics.
Well, and with the style of the comic itself, the comic is very, like, garish oil paints and pastels and things like that. They're just, like, smeared across. Like, everything feels smeared across the page and weird that way. And that adds to that style, that sense of dread and disorientation. It works in the comic.
Yeah, for sure.
In terms of that style. But, yeah, if you're just going to do it what they did here, it's... doesn't translate. Even if you put all your effects makeup on like the main villain, it's like it doesn't have that same effect of a tall warbled person because the art style is all smeared.
Yeah,
right.
And it's I feel like this movie needed like a I don't want to say stronger voice, but like a more like creative. Like I think they just tried to make it too straightforward of just straight
it needed
up
to be
vampire
campy.
Monster. Yeah,
someone was like, "We got to make a movie on based off this comic, so make it." I've never just make it.
Yeah,
make it as is like. Well, okay, what?
I'm not even sure if it needed to be campy. Like, campy would have been great, and it would have been nice to have just something in it. It needed to be campier or meaner. Like, it needed to be, like, the tone I was looking for in this one, or at least hoping for in this one, was kind of like the remake of Fright Night, where it's got a little bit of a comedic edge to it. Little bit of a comedic edge, but the vampires are frightening and mean.
In fact, you could have... The way they structured this, you could have even had the vampires be a smaller part of the movie because they kill almost everyone in the first like hour or first 40 minutes of the movie.
Yeah.
And it's like you could have just had built this town as like these people with their dramas. And then the very last part of it is suddenly all the vampire stuff happens and then it's quick. It's lightning fast. And wow, what a way to just knock that one out. Like, shift them to the back, maybe. Like, that'd be how I would at least think to approach it.
I would have just done it differently and had it be like, yep, we're heading into 30 days a night. I wonder who we're going to lose this year. We always lose somebody. It always just happens. It gets too cold. They get lost, whatever.
Oh, yeah.
And it's just on him to make sure we lose as few people as possible. So when people start disappearing, he's like, yeah, it happens. It's the nighttime. We're always trying to make sure, but we'll find them in the snow later. We'll bury them then.
And then suddenly
we're losing a shitload of people.
Yeah.
And then it starts, like, that's how I would have approached it.
Yeah, the spiral out of control.
Yeah, play with the 30 days a night. Don't make it just hide in an attic for 30 days until you decide to move somewhere.
Well, you hide in the attic, then you go back to the police station, and then you go to, I don't know what factory it was supposed to be.
I don't know. But they keep hiding in places that are blatantly obvious, and it's annoying they haven't been found, because they're the only people there.
Well, because it's also, they've never established how the vampires, or these creatures, operate when they rest, because it's 30 days a night, so they don't have daytime to fall asleep. The rules of the vampires don't make any sense because they don't have any.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no like sense of like strategy for on either side when it comes down to it. Because well, if it's dark all the time, the vampires never have to sleep. So where do they go? Like, where's their brood? Because they come out of the
woodwork. I would have slept in the grocery store. Maybe like the humans are gonna come here at some point.
Yeah, but that's the other thing. Is like, so they never sleep. Fine, whatever. But they also have to eat. Like, they still have to eat. They eat everybody in about 20 minutes. And they're supposed to go like 29 days with nobody else. And then every now and then a human will walk out. Like, where were they keeping that human?
And they're so wasteful with the kills, which makes it, again, that
they
30 days.
Blood everywhere.
Yeah.
So both humans and the vampires don't seem to have a very good sense of survivability in 30 days of just stranded out in the middle of nowhere at night.
Yeah.
Which is a very interesting thing for this movie that has such a, I really like the premise of this. And yeah, coming into the idea of it, the beginning of it, like, at least for that very first part of the movie, I'm just like all on board. Like, yeah. And then it goes down and it just takes such a left turn.
And another thing that annoyed me.
Oh, please.
There's just a list. I am a fan of vampires. Been a fan since, you know, my angsty teenage years, and I felt like I could identify with their problems. And every version of a vampire has a law or rule, ritual of how you turn people into a vampire.
Right.
Whether or not it's with a scratch, a bite, or that you make them drink your blood or whatnot, it's established at some point. And in this movie, at one fairly early on, the main baddie says, "And we will turn no one," or something similar to that.
I think it just says "turn nobody."
Yeah, so that implies a ritual.
Right.
A situation, a special thing. And then it turns out, no, this is one of those movies where if you just get a cut or a slight bite, you turn. And
Which then
people get turned.
Which then causes a problem for the very last scene where she kisses him on the lips, which are all bloodied by...
Then she should have turned into a vampire.
Right.
Yep.
So the rules of the vampires don't exist in this either. Yeah. Which is too bad. Like, especially since I've been reading dozens of books of vampire, like, books. And those rules are clearly defined.
And
But
that's the thing, is like, if this movie just didn't want to have rules and just wanted to be a vampire, just monster fest, then it needed to have more of a clear, like, either sense of humor or just purpose or something, because it just feels like a movie that's constantly trying to appease everyone.
Right.
Like, if you're a horror movie fan, you're gonna like this. If you like westerns, you're gonna like this. If you like vampires, you're gonna like this. Like, it just felt like it was just trying to cast as huge of a net as possible, and it's like, you just missed everything.
Because there's a way you can make that work where the rules aren't known, but then you see less of them.
Yeah.
And side more POV of the humans. So we don't see those vampire who talks moments. We don't see any of them. They're just out there in the darkness. And we don't know their rules because we don't see them. We don't get it. Like, they have to learn it through. So then you can give yourself more of an out that way.
I just would have never had him talk.
Yeah.
Like, you could keep the movie the entirely the same. If you never the vampires talk, then our complaint here goes away. Don't turn anyone. That line now, just like Chewie said, proves that there is a way that we turn people.
He did say, make sure to cut off their heads, which I guess is the way to make sure you don't turn them. But
yeah, that's pretty effective.
They're not very good at that then.
No, the one dude turns super easy. Just gets a scratch on the leg.
Yeah. And a vampire should have known that.
So yeah.
How he was able to...
But and also the time to turn is also...
Immediate.
Unspecific. It's either immediate or, in Josh Hartnett's case, a long time.
No, so, Josh Hartnett starts turning within 30 seconds.
Oh, yeah. He injects himself.
But, sorry, I mean lose yourself. Because it's implied that you lose control of yourself, of who you are.
Oh, no. He explained that in the line of dialogue. Because he wasn't a bite. He chose to become one. He figured that out real fast. I don't know how he figured it out. He's like, oh, the rest of them turn because of bites. But I'm choosing it.
Okay.
It's a hell of a gamble there, Josh.
Yeah, no.
Sorry, Eben.
Eben. And again, the names on this were specifically... Very. I got annoyed because there was a character called Malachi, which is a biblical name, a big name, you know, usually a moment of like, oh, this person's important. No,
right.
He was a one-off, and he never comes back. Like, why do you name him Malachi then?
It's a very comic booky thing to do. Just have interesting names on a page.
Yeah,
but
it reads well.
You could have named Josh Hartnett Malachi and the other guy Eben.
Yeah.
It's more of like that word, that name looks good on the page, like you're saying.
It's a comic book thing. But that's the where I'm coming from at the end of this thing. And like we haven't been talking that long, but there's just not that much to say, kind of how Chewie said in the beginning. And it's just all of this stuff. I feel like we are so nitpicky on this one, but it's because there's nothing that works other than the idea of the movie. The premise is good. everything from there on out is just like, well, I wouldn't have done that.
And that's the frustrating thing about that.
Yeah. And this is a genre that is hard to pin down, honestly. Because really the only one that I can think of that comes to mind is The Thing. Fright Night's not in the middle of a snow blizzard.
Oh, you mean
thing.
The snow thing, yeah.
Because they had that one with
Alien
Kate
vs.
Beckinsale. No.
Not Alien vs. Predator?
No. Well, that did happen. Yeah, but they were in a pyramid, so the snow really wasn't that important.
There's a pyramid under the snow. I'll stop. You're thinking of Whiteout with Kate Beckinsale?
Yeah. Again, a movie that just not that good.
I do like that. And it's weird now that I've been in California for long enough. I like seeing the snow in this movie. Oh. It was a fun thing, which is a weird thing to pick out the second time watching. But I'm like, oh, snow boots crunching through the snow. How nice. And I can tell it's getting to the end of the year when we go back, you know, back north for the snow. Because I was like, this is cool. I miss this. I mean, I even started our D&D campaign in the middle of a tundra because I was like, snow. It's that time of the year. So yeah, that was fun. That was a positive element to the movie. Snow.
At least there's snow.
But and again though, like for how cold it's supposed to be, being on top of the world, they're really loosey-goosey about their outerwear.
Their coats? Yeah.
Oh my god.
I lost my coat. I'm just gonna be without. It's like, in barrel?
I'd wear at least a hat.
Yeah.
Or a hood that stays on.
Yeah, you're talking about waiting for weather that's impossible to travel in, and then you're going to go out in it.
Yeah, you should all be in giant snowsuits.
I wear a hat.
See, that would have been interesting, having not just the vampires be the problem, but frostbite.
Yeah.
Death
well,
by
that's,
weather.
That's what I mean by they should have changed. I mean, their lips get kind of chapped near the end of the movie, but that's it. Like, the process of time is not handled well.
I think we should move on to quotes. It's going to be a real short episode. But there's just not that much to say.
Yeah, there's not really anything positive I can say. The production design didn't grab me. I was trying to read the posters in the background because I was bored.
The good things to say are Josh Hartnett was okay. Melissa George was okay.
Josh Hartnett was better than this movie. Like he
Ben Foster was the best thing in the movie.
Yeah, because he never doesn't put his best performance.
He's almost always the best thing in any movie.
It was nice to see these people. Yeah. Some of these people because we haven't seen them lately. Like, I haven't seen Josh Hartnett in much lately.
No, not since Penny Dreadful stopped.
Yeah.
I'm sure he's still acting.
Oh, he's always acting.
Yeah.
He's just not anything.
And he was really good in Penny Dreadful. Like, really good in that. So it was nice to see him again. Like,
I was going back to Lucky Number 11. He was so good in that movie.
Oh, yeah.
All right. So quotes. Mine is actually a Josh Hartnett quote. It comes when they're like, we need to figure out if we make it today, will we be okay? Like, we think that they're a problem have a daylight because they wanted to wait till the nighttime, but we don't know. So they go into the house where they're growing pot and they steal one of the UV lights and they're going to fry the main vampire's girlfriend, favorite, I don't know.
No.
So anyhow, it works. And he gets on the radio with his girlfriend. He's like, it works. But they're probably going to turn off the power. And then as soon as he starts saying that they cut off the power, he's like, whoop, got to go.
And it never comes back. He doesn't try to take any of those light bulbs with him to use later.
Well, it wasn't that effective. Yeah, it wasn't that effective.
It basically killed her. Took her out of commission.
It was an underplayed moment.
I think it worked because and that's the reason why I like the quote too. I think it worked because all they were trying to do was confirm that if we get to daylight, are we okay, or do we need to come up with a plan B? UV rays hurt them? And they found out yes.
That was like the strategy was employed. A theory was tested, and like survivability was practiced.
Yep.
And I was like, that was actually, I sat up in my seat for that. Yep. So yeah, it was.
That sequence actually works.
Yeah.
I see what Chewie's meaning. Like, it would make more sense. Like, all right, well, maybe I should carry one because where we're going, they could have power. These would be helpful.
Yeah. But this is this movie.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm taking it as positively as I can.
Yeah.
My quote is near the end, which is epitomizes how dumb this movie is after Eben injects himself with the vampire blood and he goes to Jake he said, Jake is his, I'm 25, but I'm pretending to be 15-year-old brother.
Right.
And he says, take care of Stella. And I'm like, are you serious? You're separated from this woman. She isn't really in love with you anymore. And you're telling your 15-year-old brother to take care of her?
Yeah, you didn't pick her up at the beginning of the movie.
He's telling him to kill her. Take care of her.
No. What? It's just so dumb on multiple levels.
The writer calls in. Yeah, that was the whole point.
Yep, that was it.
He's
like, Your brother is obviously an idiot. He has not really been useful this whole movie. He's 15. This woman works for the Marshal Service or
Fire Marshal.
Fire Marshal. She can handle herself.
Yeah.
So, just fuck you.
Yeah. Who's dying in this situation? Is she dying or are you dying? I think you're dying. She'll be fine.
Yeah.
Get out of your patriarchy.
Pretty much.
So my quote comes from the section in the supermarket with the wild, like the crazy little vampire girl, which is, I think, the tone that the movie maybe would have been best served going toward is just that crazy, really wild Resident Evil style, like go ridiculous. I think that's where that should have gone in the movie. And I think this scene was one that I liked out because of it. And it's the line, "I'm done playing with this one. You want to play with me now?" And I think it's a good review of the movie itself too, because like I'm done with this one now.
Yeah.
I also didn't like her performance. I didn't like anything about this movie.
It was so cheesy, though. It was so cheesy and ridiculous and something that was trying to take itself so seriously.
But her performance also made her go like, wait, was she in this movie earlier?
Was she here before? I was like, is this movie trying to be self-aware?
The way she says, will you play with me now, is like they didn't play with her earlier. The delivery was off for me. Like, were you in a cutscene when someone said, go away, little girl?
I want to play. Get out of here. Do you want to play with me now? Well, no, now you're a vampire. I didn't want to before when you're being annoying. Now you're going to kill me.
Yeah.
Oi, so this was the...
It's a rough way to start the horror month.
Well, I mean, it only goes up from here.
Yeah.
Which is saying something with our next movie, which we'll get to after our review system, which I think is the most apt review system I've ever had for a movie. I've said that before. How many days of night would you give 30 days of night?
I'd give it to about 9 p.m. and then I'd turn it off. It's only been dark for about 2 hours, but I already can't. I'm done.
So not even a close to a single night.
No.
From Chewie. I would just go, I'd give it a week.
A week? Okay.
Give it a week. It's kind of weak. I don't like using the same word.
Yeah, I'd give it maybe 2 or 3 days, just long enough to survive the initial onslaught, being very self-congratulatory about it, but sneezing in my hiding place and getting completely chewed apart.
Yeah, that works.
Yeah.
So that was our first episode of Horror Month. Clearly, we were not huge fans of it.
I can't stress enough that I did want to have a different movie for this, but I also had fun. I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm sorry for bringing the bar so low in the beginning, but... At the same time, it was cheesy. It was just, you know, it was a horror film.
I've seen worse movies.
Yeah.
And like it was funny when you said this one, I'm like, oof. Okay, I said whatever you guys wanted to pick. I'm not going to say no. The only reason I said no to the other ones is because I didn't want to buy it.
Right. And the idea...
We're more cheap than we are worried about quality.
Yeah. But also, it's fun sometimes to just... have a low stakes takedown.
Yeah, this was a
pun intended.
And luckily, I think throughout the rest of the horror month, this is the only one that I will outright dislike. And starting next week, we have Woof. This one was a heavy movie, but still definitely had a way better sense of humor than 30 Days a Night, which is weird for the genre. I'll let Chewie introduce it. It's a mind fuck for sure.
So I chose the movie Revenge, which. Oddly enough, Facebook and other social media places targeted marketed me to this movie. It is from 2017. It is a French rape revenge film, which why I was targeted marketed to this, I really couldn't tell you because I am not a fan of that genre. Usually it is very much a male dominated, male gaze idea of feminism. Essentially, a lot of times people would be like, but I married this. The woman killed all the dudes. And I'm like,
it's a thinly veiled excuse.
Yeah, but then you really had her raped for a while previously and you kind of tried to make it sexy. And I didn't like that. So don't tell me you're a feminist. But this movie was directed.
Did none of that.
Huh? Did none of that.
No.
And it was written and directed by a female woman director, Coralie Fargy.
Forgay? I don't know. It's a French name.
I'm terrible at French. It's a rape revenge film. We'll go into it next week.
Yep.
And I would say it does a wonderful job at spoofing at the beginning, being true to the genre with the instigating and then just kicking its ass the rest of the film.
Oh, yeah.
And definitely not safe for work. And John watched it at work.
let's bleep that out. Like, I don't, people don't need to know. The building was empty, goddammit.
Okay, so let's do a very, very quick round of plugs for the rest of the ATH Network, and then we'll get out of this. So, as I just said, listen to every show on the ATH Network, which includes Venture Bros, Samwise, Demon Days, Us on Thursdays, and then Damage Boost on Fridays. Be sure to go to our website now. Featuring a new article by Matt Dykes every single Friday about the entirety of Stargate. It is awesome. I highly recommend you check it out. What else am I missing?
Emily's also got her other voices.
Yes. Why do I always forget other voices? She and I even had a long conversation about those articles. They're great. You should definitely read those as well.
Yeah.
Those are on Mondays, right?
Yeah, Mondays. Mondays. I've been wondering, like, I need a new thing, like a new list of movies to watch. What haven't I seen? And then her article started coming out and it was like, oh, here's a bunch of things I've missed that I feel like need the attention. This is great.
Yes.
Yeah. We should maybe even have her do Revenge later.
It's actually not a bad idea. Yeah. If we get her to watch it. one more plug coming from Chewie. It started up.
A Superstore, there yes. It premiered yesterday. No, 2 days ago, which would have been probably 2 weeks ago when this airs.
A week and a day.
Superstore. Coming back strong, you know. In that store, the employees, we start, you know...
Clocking back in?
I mean, we deal with ice in the first episode, so might not be the most hilarious episode, but it's definitely poignant and good.
Given how the last season ended, I would imagine you deal with ice in the first episode. So excited to see what happens to Mateo, but it was so sad.
Yeah.
That's everything. So thank you so much for listening, and bye.
Bye.
Bozos.